Okay. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for the introduction. So, my name is Davide Calandra, and the topic I choose for today's talk is just a subset of my research topics, as you said, that are interaction and simulation in extended reality experiences. And so let's start with the term of extended reality, which some of you may not be familiar with. And extended reality is a broad term that includes different immersive technologies. They go from the augmented reality, which usually consists in superimposing virtual elements over the real world, for example, on a screen of a classic mobile phone or using dedicated head-mounted devices, for example, holographic devices. Then, on the other side, there is virtual reality, in which the full field of view of the user is covered with virtual content, and the user is completely immersed in a simulated environment, interactive environment, and usually interaction is performed by means of hand controllers. And then there is mixed reality, which is a sort of advanced augmented reality in which the virtual and real elements coexist and interact in the same simulation. And all these technologies have in common one aspect, that is they are very good at displaying stuff. They are very good at playing sounds, but for what it concerns the other senses, the situation is not so rosy. So, forgetting about smell and taste that are also completely forgotten also, from the point of view of the commercial solutions, the haptics is one of the most interesting one of the, apart from the first two that are already working flawlessly, let's say. Which is the issue with the simulation of haptics? Delivering high fidelity haptic is very complex because the somatosensory system of the human body is distributed across the whole body and not centralized like eyes and ears. So it's difficult to provide this kind of feedback spatially. And it's also related to a wide range of different stimuli that can be categorized in two main categories, which are tactile, mainly related to the skin, so like shape, texture, or vibrations, and kinesthetic, which is at the level of joints and muscles, so it is responsible for the perception of 3D shapes, weights, and forces. And from this point of view, different solutions have been in the last years proposed by both investigated by the literature, but also the, let's say, the commercial solutions are starting to appear. And they have very different characteristics in terms of functionality, flexibility, cost, and also, let's say, mode of functioning. For example, one of the most common are the handheld devices, in which we can narrate the hand controllers for virtual reality, which are, other than interfaces with the virtual elements, also haptic devices, because they can vibrate, so they can provide an active tactile feedback, and they have a shape, so they can also provide a passive feedback. Then another class of devices are the wearable, which are gaining importance in the last years, and new solutions are being commercialized. Although they are still, let's say, a bit immature, and they, for example, can be gloves or thimbles to be put on fingers, and they can also provide kinesthetic feedback, for example, to exoskeletons or mechanical structures. Then another common class are the props, which are very specialized. They usually represent the shape, weight of the tool that have to be simulated in the virtual environment. And they usually are not so flexible, like, for example, hand controllers. So the problem of simulating a virtual element in terms of optics is really complex, and you have to take into consideration the functionalities of the device you select for the purpose. For example, starting with the passive props, one thing that could be investigated is the possibility to make them reconfigurable. So instead of having static items, you can try to subdivide them in small elements. And for example, as we did in this work, we proposed a way to create them on the basis of construction bricks, and they can be also repurposed in the context of the same application. So for example, a tool can, in a different part of the same application, can change its purpose and can also be, for example, modified without that the user recognizes this. For example, I can ask him to insert the object in another one, and then later in the same application, that object will become a different tool. Then another issue with these interfaces is the measurability of their impact on the overall simulation. In fact, for example, taking this example, that's a real use case, the training of wildland firefighters of Piedmont region, we collaborated with them and created a VR simulation of a use of three hand tools, which are a shovel, a rake, and a firefighting beater. In this case, we wanted to measure which was the impact of these interfaces on the outcome of the learning, because it was deployed on a real, let's say, training context. To do so, we organized an experiment, and we introduced the use of the VR simulation enriched with these passive optics interfaces, and we compared it with the standard traditional course, which was mainly based on videos. So we also included in the comparison a real-world practice with the same tools, the real tools, in order to discern between the contribution of the physical tool, so I just trained with the real shovel, and the contribution of the simulation in virtual reality. So in this case, we measured that the use of virtual reality enriched with passive optics significantly improved the final result of the exam of the students of the firefighting course with respect to both the standard course and the course followed by a normal practice session. And at the same time, it improved the attention and motivation with respect to the course. Moving then to the simulation of active elements, in this case you have to rely to different devices, like for instance the one you can see on the left, which is an exoskeleton-based glove, provided with both vibrotactile and kinesthetic feedback. And one question that could be arises can be the same level of functionality obtained with a set of simpler devices like the one you can see on the left, on the right. On the right, there is a couple of vibrotactile gloves, so without the kinesthetic structure, so simpler, and a prop. In this case, it is a 3D printed shell of an electric screwdriver, because the simulation was of this tool, so a carpentry tool, which has been tracked using a hand controller. So there is a hand controller just for align the prop with the virtual element. And the task of that was simulated was a screwdriving process. So to obtain a high level of fidelity in this particular task, we had to reproduce the real world vibrations of an electric screwdriver inside the virtual environment. So we harvested the vibrations in terms of frequency, and we try to re-implement it on the selected hardware. So for each of the different phases of the screwing, so when the tip touches the the SQ when the tip is at the end of the loose screwing, etc. And interestingly, from this comparison, it emerged that out of the, let's say, only one more complex exoskeleton-based device was perceived as better in faithfully represent the screwing tightening phases and, for example, the contact of the with the screw. It was also significantly less easy, so harder to wear, less comfortable, and it lacked also in terms of passive feedback, so representing the shape of the electric screwdriver. This is because the kinesthetic passive feedback was obtained by blocking the fingers with the mechanical tendons, whereas the passive haptic pop has a proper shape was perceived as better. So in the overall preference, people like more the simpler but compound solution, showing the immaturity of the other kind of device. The second step of this research was to identify the single contribution of each of the elements of the compound solution. So we try to operate a breakdown analysis, and we defined three sub-configurations of the compound solution. So using only the vibro-tactile gloves, so only providing active tactile feedback, adding just the controller. So the controller in this case acted as a low fidelity passive haptic prop for the electric screwdriver, and then the full solution, the first investigation, adding the 3D printed shell as a high fidelity haptic device. And in this case, results showed that the presence of a passive haptic component, being it low fidelity, like the controller, or high fidelity, so also with a shell representing the exact shape of the real electric screwdriver, provided the best results. Whereas the use of the gloves was just seen as more innovative than the use of controller, but it was worse under any other point of view. So in conclusion, we can say that haptics is a key element of the advancements of XR and has the potential to greatly enhance the user experience in any VR, AR, or MR application. But it's still very immature, and it requires new investigations and probably new devices, which are in continuous evolution, because every month a new device is presented, commercial or non-commercial. And so it has the power to transform the way we learn, interact, train, and also play in extended reality. Thank you, everyone, if you have some questions.